This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Whitewater controversy, also known as the Whitewater scandal, or simply Whitewater, began with an investigation into the real estate investments of Bill and Hillary Clinton and their associates, Jim and Susan McDougal, in the Whitewater Development Corporation, a failed business venture in the 1970s and 1980s. A March 1992 New York Times article published during the U.S. presidential campaign reported that the Clintons, then governor and first lady of Arkansas, had invested and lost money in the Whitewater Development Corporation. The article stimulated the interest of L. McDougal, the Clintons' partner in the Whitewater land deal. Clinton supporters regarded Hale's allegations as questionable, as Hale had not mentioned Clinton in reference to this loan during the original FBI investigation of Madison Guaranty in 1989. Only after coming under indictment in 1993, did Hale make allegations against the Clintons. A U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission investigation did result in convictions against the McDougals for their role in the Whitewater project. Jim Guy Tucker, Bill Clinton's successor as governor, was convicted of fraud and sentenced to 4 years of probation for his role in the matter. Susan McDougal served 18 months in prison for contempt of court for refusing to answer questions relating to Whitewater. The Clintons themselves were never prosecuted, after three separate inquiries found insufficient evidence linking them with the criminal conduct of others related to the land deal, and Susan McDougal was granted a pardon by President Clinton before he left office. The term Whitewater is sometimes used to include other controversies from the Bill Clinton administration, especially Travelgate, Filegate, Chinagate, and the circumstances surrounding Vince Foster's death that were also investigated by the Whitewater Independent Counsel. Contents 1 History 11 Origins of Whitewater Development Corporation 12 Failure of Whitewater Development Corporation 13 Bill Clinton's first run for president 14 Removal of documents 15 Subpoena of the presidential couple 16 The Kenneth Starr investigation 17 Reaction of the Clintons 18 Reaction of Congress 2 Convictions 3 Tax returns 4 Wray Report 5 Epilogue 6 See also 7 References 8 External links History Origins of Whitewater Development Corporation The Clintons lived in this 980 square feet 91. Little Rock from 1977 to 1979 while he was Arkansas Attorney General. The couple's modest circumstances led them to seek outside investment income. Bill Clinton had known Arkansas businessman and political figure Jim McDougal since 1968, and had made a previous small real estate investment with him in 1977. The Clintons were seeking ways of supplementing their income. Bill Clinton's salary was $26,500 as Arkansas Attorney General, which would rise to $35,000 if his campaign for governor of Arkansas succeeded, and Hillary Clinton's salary was $24,500 as a Rose Law Firm associate for a combined income in 1978 of $51,173, equivalent to $186,000 in 2015. It was around this time that Hillary Clinton also began trading cattle futures in spring of 1978. McDougal proposed that the Clintons join him and his wife, Susan, in buying 230 acres 093. One weekend here and you'll never want to live anywhere else. The business was incorporated on June 18, 1979. Failure of Whitewater Development Corporation. By the time the Whitewater lots were surveyed and available for sale at the end of 1979, interest rates had climbed to near 20%. Prospective buyers could no longer afford to buy vacation homes rather than take a loss on the venture. The four decided to build a model home and wait for better economic conditions. The White River, near Flippin, Arkansas, and the intended site of the Whitewater Development Corporation's vacation home. Following the land purchase, Jim McDougal asked the Clintons for additional funds for interest payments on the loan and other expenses. The Clintons later claimed to have no knowledge of how these contributions were used. When Bill Clinton failed to win re-election in 1980, Jim McDougal lost his job as the governor's economic aide and decided to go into banking. He acquired the Bank of Kingston in 1980 and the Woodruff Savings. Of that was in Madison Guaranty cashier's checks in 1985. Jim McDougal invested in a local construction project called Castle Grande, the 1,000 acres for of Madison Guaranty cost the United States $73 million. The Clintons lost between $37,000 and $69,000 on their Whitewater investment. This was less than the McDougals lost. The reasons for the unequal capital contributions by the Clintons and McDougals are unknown, but the president's critics cited the discrepancy as evidence that then-Governor Clinton was to contribute to the project in other ways. The White House and the president's supporters claimed that they were exonerated by the Pillsbury Report. This was a $3 million study done for the Resolution Trust Corporation by the Pillsbury, Madison. Removal of documents within hours of the death of Vince Foster in July 1993. Chief White House Counsel Bernard Nussbaum removed documents, some of them concerning the Whitewater Development Corporation, from Foster's office and gave them to Maggie Williams, Chief of Staff to the First Lady. According to the New York Times, Williams placed the documents in a safe in the White House for 5 days before turning them over to their personal lawyer. Subpoena of the presidential couple. Hillary Rodham Clinton worked on the third floor of Rose Law Firm. Her billing record from the mid-1980s would become the subject of intrigue during the Whitewater controversy as a result of the exposé in the New York Times. The Justice Department opened an investigation into the failed Whitewater deal. Media pressure continued to build, and on April 22, 1994, Hillary Clinton gave an unusual press conference under a portrait of Abraham Lincoln in the state dining room of the White House, to address questions on both Whitewater and the cattle futures controversy. It was broadcast live on several networks. In it, she claimed that the Clintons had a passive role in the Whitewater venture and had committed no wrongdoing, but admitted that her explanations had been vague. She said that she no longer opposed appointing a special prosecutor to investigate the matter afterwards. She won media praise for the manner in which she conducted herself during the press conference. Time called her open, candid, but above all unflappable. The real message was her attitude and her poise. The confiding tone and relaxed body language immediately drew approving reviews. By that time there was growing backlash from Democrats and other members of the political left against the press's investigations of Whitewater. The New York Times was criticized by Gene Lyons of Harper's Magazine, who felt its reporters were exaggerating the significance and possible impropriety of what they were uncovering at Clinton's request. Attorney General Janet Reno appointed a special prosecutor, Robert B. Fisk, to investigate the legality of the Whitewater transactions in 1994. Two allegations surfaced, one that Clinton had exerted pressure on an Arkansas businessman, David Hale, to make a loan that would benefit him and the owners of Madison Guaranty, and two that an Arkansas bank had concealed transactions involving Clinton's gubernatorial campaign in 1990. In May 1994, Fisk issued a grand jury subpoena to the president and his wife for all documents relating to Madison Guaranty, with a deadline of 30 days. They were reported as missing by the Clintons almost 2 years later. The subpoenaed billing records of the Rose Law Firm were discovered in the Clintons' private residence in the White House by a staffer. The Kenneth Starr investigation. In August 1994, Kenneth Starr was appointed by a three-judge panel to continue the Whitewater investigation, replacing Robert B. Fisk, who had been specially appointed by the Attorney General. Prior to the reenactment of the independent counsel law, Fisk was replaced because he had been chosen and appointed by Janet Reno, Clinton's Attorney General, creating a conflict of interest. David Hale, the key witness against President Clinton in Starr's Whitewater investigation, alleged in November 1992 that Clinton, while governor of Arkansas, pressured him to provide an illegal $300,000 loan to Susan McDougal, the partner of the Clintons in the Whitewater deal. Hale's defense strategy, as proposed by Attorney Randy Coleman, was to present himself as the victim of high-powered politicians who forced him to give away all of the money. This self-caricature was undermined by testimony from November 1989, wherein FBI agents investigating the failure of Madison Guaranty had questioned Hale about his dealings with Jim and Susan McDougal, including the $300,000 loan. According to the agent's official memorandum of that interview, Hale described in some detail his dealings with Jim Guy Tucker, then an attorney in private practice, later Bill Clinton's lieutenant governor, both McDougal's, and several others, but never mentioned Governor Bill Clinton. Clinton denied that he pressured Hale to approve the loan to Susan McDougal. By this time, Hale had already pleaded guilty to two felonies and secured a reduction in his sentence in exchange for his testimony against Bill Clinton. Charges were made by Clinton supporters that Hale had received numerous cash payments from representatives of the so-called Arkansas Project, a $24 million campaign established to assist in Hale's defense strategy, and to investigate Clinton and his associates between 1993 and 1997. These charges were the topic of a separate investigation by former Department of Justice investigator Michael E. Shaheen Jr. Shaheen filed his report in July 1999 to Starr, who stated that the allegations that Hale had been paid in hopes of influencing his testimony were unsubstantiated or, in some cases, untrue. Furthermore, no charges were brought against Hale or the Arkansas Project outlet. The American Spectator writers from Ceylon complained that the full, 168-page report had not been made public, a complaint still being reiterated by Ceylon as of 2001. State prosecutors issued an arrest warrant for Hale in early July 1996, charging that Hale had misrepresented the solvency of his insurance company, National Savings Life, to the state insurance commission. The prosecutors also alleged in court papers that Hale had made those misrepresentations to conceal the fact that he had looted the insurance company. Hale said that any infraction was a technicality and that no one had lost any money in March 1999. Hale was convicted of the first charge, with the jury recommending a 21-day jail sentence. Starr drafted an impeachment referral to the House of Representatives in the fall of 1997, alleging that there was substantial and credible evidence that Bill Clinton had committed perjury regarding Hale's allegations. Theodore B. Olson, who with several associates, launched the plan that later became known as the Arkansas Project, wrote several essays for the American Spectator, accusing Clinton and many of his associates of wrongdoing. The first of those pieces appeared in February 1994, alleging a wide variety of criminal offenses by the Clintons and others, including Webster Hubbell. These allegations led to the discovery that Hubbell, a friend and former Rose Law Firm partner of Hillary Clinton, had committed multiple frauds, mostly against his own firm Hillary Clinton, instead of being complicit in Hubbell's crimes, had been among his victims in December 1994, 1 week after Hubbell pleaded guilty to mail fraud and tax evasion. Associate White House counsel, Jane C. Sherburne, created a task list which included a reference to monitoring Hubbell's cooperation with Starr. Hubbell was later recorded in prison saying, "I need to roll over one more time," regarding the Rose Law Firm lawsuit. In his next court appearance, he pleaded the Fifth Amendment against self-incrimination. See United States v. Hubbell. In February 1997, Starr announced he would leave the investigation to pursue a position at the Pepperdine University School of Law. However, he flip-flopped in the face of intense criticism and new evidence of sexual misconduct by April 1998, diverted to some degree by the burgeoning Lewinsky scandal. Starr's investigations in Arkansas were winding down, with his Little Rock grand jury about to expire. Hubbell, Jim Guy Tucker, and Susan McDougal had all refused to cooperate with Starr. Tucker and McDougal were later pardoned by President Clinton when the Arkansas grand jury did conclude its work in May 1998. After 30 months in panel, it came up with only a contempt indictment against Susan McDougal, although she refused to testify under oath regarding the Clintons' involvement in Whitewater. Susan McDougal did make the case in the media that the Clintons had been truthful in their account of the loan, and had cast doubt on her former husband's motives for cooperating with Starr. She also claimed that James McDougal felt abandoned by Clinton, and told her he was going to pay back the Clintons. She said to the press, again not under oath, that her husband had told her that Republican activist and Little Rock lawyer, Sheffield Nelson, was willing to pay him some money for talking to the New York Times about Bill Clinton, and in 1992, he told her that one of Clinton's political enemies was paying him to tell the New York Times about Whitewater from the beginning. Susan McDougal charged that Starr offered her global immunity from other charges if she would cooperate with the Whitewater investigation. McDougal told the jury that refusing to answer questions about the Clintons and Whitewater wasn't easy for her, or her family. "It's been a long road, a very long road, and it was not an easy decision to make," McDougal told the court. McDougal refused to answer any questions while under oath, leading to her being imprisoned by the judge for civil contempt of court for the maximum 18 months, including 8 months in isolation. Starr's subsequent indictment of McDougal for criminal contempt of court charges resulted in a jury hung 7-5, in favor of acquittal. President Clinton later pardoned her. Shortly before leaving office, see list of people pardoned by Bill Clinton in September 1998. Independent counsel Starr released the Starr Report, concerning offenses alleged to have been committed by President Clinton. As part of the Lewinsky scandal, the report mentioned Whitewater only in passing. Clinton friend and advisor, Vernon Jordan, had tried to help Webster Hubbell financially with no-show consulting contracts steps while he was under pressure to cooperate with the Whitewater investigations. Indeed, it was on this basis that Starr took on the Lewinsky investigation. Under the umbrella of the Whitewater Independent Counsel mandate, there was much acrimony from the most fervent critics of the Clintons. After the release of the Starr report on the Foster matter and after Starr's departure and return to the case, the death of Foster had been the source of many conspiracy theories. Christopher Ruddy, a reporter for Richard Mellon Chase's Pittsburgh Tribune Review, helped fuel much of this speculation with claims that Starr had not pursued this line of inquiry far enough. Reaction of the Clintons on January 26, 1996. Hillary Clinton testified before a grand jury concerning her investments in Whitewater. This was the first time in American history that a first lady had been subpoenaed to testify before a grand jury. She testified that they never borrowed any money from the bank, and denied having caused anyone to borrow money on their behalf. Reaction of Congress. Parallel to the independent counsel track, both houses of the United States Congress had been investigating Whitewater and holding hearings on it. The House Committee on Financial Services had been scheduled to begin hearings in late March 1994, but they were postponed after an unusually angry, written communication from Democratic Banking Committee Chair Henry B. Gonzales to Republican Jim Leach. Gonzales called Leach obstinate, obdurate, in willful disregard of House etiquette, and premeditatedly plotting a judicial adventure. The House Banking Committee began its hearings in late July 1994. The Senate Banking, Housing, and Urban Affairs Committee also began hearings on Whitewater in July 1994. These hearings intensified in May 1995, following the Republican gain of control, when the Republican Banking Committee Chairman Al D'Amato also became chair of the newly formed Special Whitewater Committee. The Whitewater Committee's hearings were much more extensive than those held previously by the Democrats, running for 300 hours over 60 sessions across 13 months, and taking over 10,000 pages of testimony and 35,000 pages of depositions from almost 250 people. The hearings, testimony, and senatorial lines of investigation mostly followed partisan lines, with Republicans investigating the president and the Democrats defending him. The Senate Special Whitewater Committee issued an 800-page majority report on June 18, 1996, which only hinted at one possible improper action by President Clinton, but spoke of the Clinton administration as an American presidency misused its power, circumvented the limits on its authority, and attempted to manipulate the truth. The First Lady came in for much stronger criticism, as she was the central figure in all aspects of the alleged wrongdoings. The Democratic minority on the committee called these findings a legislative travesty, a witch hunt, and a political game. On November 19, 1998, independent counsel Starr testified before the House Judiciary Committee in connection with the impeachment of Bill Clinton over charges related to the Lewinsky scandal. Starr said that in late 1997, he had considered preparing an impeachment report regarding the fraudulent $300,000 loan to Susan McDougal and the question of whether the president had testified truthfully regarding the loan. Starr said that he held back the charges because he was not sure that the two major witnesses had told the truth, but that the investigation was still ongoing regarding the reappearance of Hillary Clinton's Rose Law Firm billing records in the White House residential section. Starr said the investigation had found no explanation for the disappearance or the reappearance. After a thorough investigation, we have found no explanation how the billing records got where they were or why they were not discovered and produced earlier. It remains a mystery to this day. Starr also chose this occasion to completely exonerate President Clinton of any wrongdoing in the Travelgate and Filegate matters. Democrats on the committee immediately criticized Starr for withholding these findings, as well as the Whitewater One, until after the 1998 congressional elections. Convictions: the Clintons were never charged with any crime. 15 other persons were convicted of more than 40 crimes, including Jim Guy Tucker, who was removed from office. Jim Guy Tucker, governor of Arkansas at the time, removed from office. Fraud: 3 counts. John Haley, attorney for Jim Guy Tucker. Tax evasion: William J. Marks Sr., Jim Guy Tucker's business partner. Conspiracy: Stephen Smith, former Governor Clinton aide. Conspiracy to misapply funds: Bill Clinton pardoned Webster Hubbell, Clinton political supporter, Rose Law Firm partner. Embezzlement. Fraud: Jim McDougal, banker, Clinton political supporter, 18 felonies. Varied: Susan McDougal, Clinton political supporter. Multiple frauds: Bill Clinton pardoned David Hale, banker, self-proclaimed Clinton political supporter. Conspiracy, fraud: Neil Ainley, Perry County Bank president, embezzled bank funds for Clinton campaign. Chris Wade, Whitewater real estate broker multiple loan fraud. Bill Clinton pardoned Larry Kuka, Madison real estate agent multiple loan fraud. Robert W. Palmer, Madison appraiser conspiracy. Bill Clinton pardoned John Latham, Madison bank CEO bank fraud. LJean Lewis, Whitewater defendant multiple bribery. Charles Matthews, Whitewater defendant bribery tax returns. In March 1992, during his presidential campaign, the Clintons acknowledged that on their 1984 and 1985 tax returns, they had claimed improper tax deductions for interest payments made by the Whitewater Development Company due to the age of mistake. The Clintons were not obligated to make good the error, but Bill Clinton announced that they would nonetheless do so. Deputy White House Counsel Vince Foster looked into this matter, but did not take any action before his death on December 28, 1993. Almost 2 years after the original announcement, the Clintons did make a reimbursement payment, for $4,900, to the Internal Revenue Service. This was done just before Justice Department investigators started seeking the Clintons' Whitewater files. The payment was made without filing an amended return, possibly because the three-year period for amended return filing had passed, but did include full interest on the amount of the error, including the additional two-year delay. The Whitewater files in question, publicly released in August 1995, cast some doubt on the Clintons' assertions in the matter, as they showed that the couple was aware that the interest payments in question were paid by the Whitewater Corporation, and not them personally. Ray Report. Kenneth Starr's successor as independent counsel, Robert Ray, released a report in September 2000, that stated, "This office determined that the evidence was insufficient to prove to a jury beyond a reasonable doubt that either President or Mrs. Clinton knowingly participated in any criminal conduct." Nevertheless, Ray criticized the White House, saying that delays in the production of evidence and unmeritorious litigation by the president's lawyers severely impeded the investigation's progress, leading to a total cost of nearly $60 million. Ray's report effectively closed the Whitewater investigation. Epilogue. Bill and Hillary Clinton never visited the actual Whitewater property. In May 1985, Jim McDougal sold the remaining lots of the failed Whitewater Development Corporation to local realtor Chris Wade by 1993. There were a few occupied houses on the site, but most of the properties were still for sale. One owner, tired of the many reporters who visited the site, hung a sign saying, "Go home, idiots." By 2007, there were about 12 houses in the subdivision, with the last lot up for sale by son, Chris Wade Jr., for $25,000 in flip-in. Jim McDougal's savings and loan bank had been replaced by a variety of small businesses, most recently a barbershop. The length, expense, and results of the Whitewater investigations turned the public against the Office of the Independent Counsel. Even Kenneth Starr was opposed to it. The Independent Counsel law was allowed to expire in 1999. Indeed, no one ended up happy with the Whitewater investigation. Democrats felt that the investigation was a political witch hunt. Republicans were frustrated that both Clintons had escaped formal charges, and those without partisan involvement found press coverage of Whitewater, which spanned four decades, difficult to understand. See also Lewinsky scandal. The hunting of the president. References. Carrot A. B. Jeff Girth, Clintons joined S. Carrot ABC. Jonathan Broder and Murray Waz, The Road to Hail, Salonkom, March 17, 1998. Accessed November 28, 2012. Carrot Murray Waz, The Story Star Did Not Want to Hear, Salonkom, August 17, 1998. Accessed August 25, 2007. Carrot Hadigan, M. 1996, Tucker Sentenced to 4 Years Probation, Washington Post 1996. Carrot AB, Ray, Insufficient Evidence to Prosecute Clinton's in Whitewater Probe, CNN, September 20, 2000. Accessed April 30, 2007. Carrot Whitewater Timeline. The Washington Post August 26, 1999. Retrieved January 28, 2008. Carrot Chozik, Amy. The 11th of August 2016. Stress over family finances propelled Hillary Clinton into corporate world. The New York Times. Retrieved the 13th of August 2016. Carrot ABCD. Pooley, Eric. April 13, 1998. Meanwhile, back in Arkansas. Time. Retrieved August 8, 2013. Clinton Simon. Christopher Ruddy. Slate. Retrieved August 8, 2013. August 27, 2007. Oslo I Accord. Israel Jordan Peace Treaty. Operation Infinite Reach. Bombing of Yugoslavia. One America Initiative. Resolute Desk. Lewinsky Scandal. Star Report. Impeachment Hearing. White House Millennium Council Pardons. State of the Union Addresses. 1994-1995-1996-1997-1998-1999. 2000 Cabinet Federal Judicial Appointments Supreme Court Controversies Life and Legacy Childhood Home Presidential Library Post Presidency Clinton Foundation Clinton School of Public Service Clinton Boulevard Clinton Bush Haiti Fund Chairman National Constitution Center Honors and Awards Public Image Sexual Misconduct Allegations Whitewater Controversy Books Between Hope and History 1996 My Life 2004 Giving, How Each of Us Can Change the World 2007 Back to Work 2011 Popular Culture The War Room 1993 Documentary Primary Colors 1998 Film Clinton 2012 Film Elections United States House of Representatives Elections, 1974 Arkansas Gubernatorial Election, 1978-1982-1984-1986-1990 Bill Clinton Presidential Campaign, 1992. Democratic Party Presidential Primaries, 1992-1996 Democratic National Convention 1992-1996 United States Presidential Election, 1992 Theme Song 1996 Family Hillary Rodham Clinton Wife Chelsea Clinton Daughter Virginia Clinton Kelly Mother William Jefferson Blythe Jr. Father Roger Clinton Sr. First Stepfather Jeff Dwyer Second Stepfather Roger Clinton Jr. Half-Brother Sox Cat Buddy Dog Whitehaven House George H. W. Bush George W. Bush Bill Clinton Category V.E. Hillary Rodham Clinton 67th United States Secretary of State 2009-2013 U.S. Senator from New York 2001-2009 First Lady of the United States 1993-2001 Secretary of State Tenure as Secretary Quadrennial Diplomacy and Development Review Foreign Policy of the Obama Administration Hillary Doctrine Email Controversy U.S. Senator Senate Career Family Entertainment Protection Act Flag Protection Act of 2005 First Lady 1993 Health Care Reform Hillaryland Travel Office Controversy FBI Files Controversy Vast Right-Wing Conspiracy Vital Voices Save America's Treasures State Children's Health Insurance Program Adoption and Safe Families Act Foster Care Independence Act White House Millennium Council National Millennium Trail Arkansas Arkansas Advocates for Children and Families Rose Law Firm Legal Services Corporation Whitewater Controversy Cattle Futures Controversy Philanthropic Clinton Foundation State Department Controversy Speeches and Policies Political Positions Women's Rights are Human Rights 1995 Writings Bibliography Senior Thesis 1969 It Takes a Village 1996 Dear Socks, Dear Buddy 1998 An Invitation to the White House 2000 Living History 2003 Hard Choices 2014 Stronger Together 2016 Electoral History New York Senatorial Election, 2000-2006 Democratic Party Presidential Primaries, 2008 Campaign Endorsements Debates Convention United States Presidential Election, 2016 Campaign Endorsements Democratic Primaries Debates Convention General Election Debates Hillary Victory Fund Legacy Awards and Honors Books about Saturday Night Live Parodies Family Bill Clinton Husband Presidency Chelsea Clinton Daughter Hugh E. Rodham Father Dorothy Howell Rodham Mother Hugh Rodham Brother Tony Rodham Brother Sox Cat Buddy Dog Whitehaven House Book Coordinates 36 degrees 13 minutes 41 seconds North 92 degrees 28 minutes 41 seconds West 36,228 degrees North 92,478 degrees West 36,228, minus 92,478 Whitewater Estates